children, because this is a day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to the Master's Word. I'm your host, Dr. Stefeni. You know, all Master's Word broadcasts are Christian internet radio programs. They're directed at educating, edifying, and helping the body of Christ to gain understanding of God's Word and to know just who they are in Christ Jesus. Let's pray. Father, we come into your precious presence with praise and thanksgiving in our hearts, overflowing our lips. We praise you, love you, and we thank you, Lord, for all that you have done and are doing. You know, Lord, we adore you and we thank and praise you that we can seek you and you'll always illuminate your word so that we gain the proper understanding of it. We thank you for the Rhema word of God, the Logos word, and for impartation, revelation, knowledge, and for the gift of utterance, and for the manifestation of your word always alive and active in our hearts. Bless those that have ears to hear today, Lord, as we endeavor to know you more personally and love you more deeply. Holy Spirit, we invite you right now to take over this broadcast. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. My friends, did you come expecting to receive from God today? Well, if not, you won't receive anything from him. So elevate your expectation level. And you know what? You're going to come away with a greater head and heart connection, a lot more knowledge, and a better understanding of God's word. Now, we're moving more deeply into the Word of God each time we meet, and that takes a greater effort on our part to enter the depth of God's presence that we've been afforded. We've found the key to entering that depth is soaking in worship, so soak with me right now.
Thank you.
Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be wholly acceptable to you, and may this be all of you and none of me. And so, Lord, let your words be my words and my words be yours, continually glorifying you in the name of the great I am, the name of Jesus. Amen. You know, each week I start with a reminder because it's imperative that we get understanding of what I'm about to tell you. And we need that understanding in order to enable us to step into the power that we have as children of God. Okay? So, as most of you know, we've talked about faith being the substantiation of things hoped for, the evidence of the supernatural substantiated and established here on earth. We've talked about our conversation, our words being on the breath of God, and whatever you're speaking is being spoken on God's breath. Now, we remember that in Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, when God created Adam, the word tells us, "Then the Lord God formed man of the dust from the ground, and he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being." So we can see then that Adam and Eve and all of mankind, including us, operate on and have God's breath. Everything we say and do is done on the breath of God, my friends. Now, when we speak about ourselves, we use the expression, I am. We even make a contraction out of it by saying, I'm. However, it's the same thing. It's God's name, which he gave to us to use, containing his power and his authority. God said in his word that he is the great I am. Since I am is his name, we can plainly see what he's done for us in giving us the use of his name. Every creation of God, including you, contain God's breath. Now, we who are born again contain God the Son as well as God's breath. And we are filled with the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God. And here's the main thing that we need to understand as believers. We represent, just as Jesus did while he was here on this earth, I am. God not only gave us his breath and life, he gave us his name to use in reference to ourselves when we speak. Why? Because he gave us his authority and dominion power, so that when we speak on his behalf as his representatives, we will do it with his great power and make lasting declarations and decrees as kings here on earth. In his name, I am.
is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter line, Lord. Your name, let the nation sing.
Listen, my friends, because God's name is our strong and mighty tower of protection, our glorious shelter and provision, our healing balm, our life and breath, beautiful, wonderful, and powerful. We should be speaking things full of life and in concert with God's word about us, like, I am feeling wonderful today. I am healed and whole. I am walking in divine health and wholeness. I am blessed beyond measure. Our mission is to speak encouraging, life-filled words into others' lives and into our own lives, because when we do, we are assured that we'll experience the good fruit that our Lord has breathed and spoken into full manifestation in our lives. You know, there's something tremendously powerful and freeing in the use of the name of God. I mean, the great I am, that name. So listen, my friends, when we decide to love our enemies and neighbors as ourselves and stop speaking death into their lives and into our own lives for that matter, we'll reach the spiritual depth that the Lord wants us to live in and on a daily basis and walk in every day. And as we practice that and it takes a firm hold in our daily life, it's then that God's lifestyle is reflected in our lives. And then mountain moving faith actively becomes the way that you live. Now this morning, we're going to embark on a new journey as we learn how, why, and what dying to self is. Okay, the power of Christian living is the essence of a being's existence, and it has to do with the fact that he's a living reality. If a person no longer has or exhibits the function of vitality, they're said to no longer exist. So the essence of death, then, is the absence of life. Therefore, when one dies, one ceases to exist. To carry the argument into the spiritual realm, when someone spiritually dies to self, self ceases to exist. That is, self is no longer the reason for one's existence. Now, this means that the individual is no longer concerned with his own will or happiness. Why? Because he's no longer in the picture. He's no longer the center of his own little universe. He no longer continues to arrange the world around himself. Actually, once one realizes that he has died to self, he should realize that to the world, he has already died and gone to heaven. In reality, he's only still here waiting for Jesus to bring him his glorified body so he can go on home. The individual who dies to self understands that God created him for a reason, that he is a part of God's plan for the world. Now, to be used of God, one has to understand the essence of who he now really is and how it is that God can use him. Every genuine child of God, my friends, wants to be used by God to accomplish his purposes in the world. Jesus said, "By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples." John 15, verse 8. That's the essence of God's plan. We are saved to bear fruit created in Christ Jesus for good works. Ephesians 2:10. So, we bear fruit when Christ lives his life in and through us. Our evidence, John 15:5 and Galatians 2, verse 20. The Apostle Paul said, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Philippians 1, verse 21. Do you ever wonder what that means? It isn't that you quit breathing. The Lord wants us to live a godly and spiritually productive, happy life. The world's philosophy says live for self, but God's word says die to self. Many people came to Jesus and asked to be his disciples, but most of them turned away. Why? Because they weren't willing to give themselves to Christ. For example, make themselves a slave of Christ. as recorded in for evidence, our evidence, in Luke 14, verse 26 and verse 33, and Luke 16, verse 13, and Romans 12, verse 1, 1 Corinthians 6, 19 through 20, and 1 Peter 1, 18 through 19. Jesus said, "He who loves his father or mother or himself more than me, he is not worthy of me." Matthew 10, 37 through 39. Then Paul said, "I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me." Galatians 2, verse 20. C.S. Lewis's literary demon character, Screwtape, has something insightful to say, too. He says, as he tells his young nephew, that humans rarely pray for the thing God wants them to pray for. They simply want enough grace to see them through some moment or time of trouble. They conjure up a vision of the future they want and appeal for that outcome. They persist in wrapping their anxious hands around life's steering wheel as if it's going to work this time if only I clutch it more tightly. You see, the most difficult prayer for us to voice is, "Not my will, but thine be done." Our conversations with God rarely leapfrog over our intellectual resolve not to ask for stuff, okay, and land squarely on the bargaining and pleading table. That's where we end up. And the best we seem to be able to do is arrive at a compromise between what we know to be right intellectually and the howl of the protest that lies within us. Listen, my friends, obedience isn't easy. Sometimes our carnal mind doesn't like the idea of God having his way and us obeying it. It's the nature of man to want things to go his way. When things don't go as we planned, when it rains on our parade, so to speak, when someone says something unbecoming to us, when our world turns upside down, when difficulties and circumstances tax us too much, when we get turned down for a promotion, when we don't get what we worked so hard to acquire, the long and short of it all is it bothers us deeply. It rubs us the wrong way, and it makes us angry. But here's the real rub. Just because we're living a life of obedience doesn't automatically make our situation better. Oh, no. Most believers think that by being obedient, the clouds will go away, the skies will turn blue, and life is just a bowl of cherries. Huh? Their financial problems will disappear, and their little nest egg will grow again. Their physical infirmities will go away, and their health will once again return. Now, sometimes these things may happen, but at other times, they just quite simply don't. Is God still good? Absolutely. We will also conclude from this, being in God's will is a far better thing than being outside of his will. Amen? So the secret to a joy-filled life doesn't lie in the absence of pain or in the demanding of our own way, but in dying to self and embracing God's will. Submission to the will of God in your prayer life may be expressed in words like these: "Father, you understand my heart, my needs, and my prayer better than I understand them myself. You know that my spiritual needs far outweigh any physical or temporary needs that I may have. And I know that your will being done in my life will give meaning, purpose, and fulfillment beyond anything I could ask or understand." Well, okay, let's get down to it. What does it mean to die to self? Well, Jesus described the dying to self process as denying self, as part of the following, part of following him. "So if anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me." Matthew 16, verse 24. Now, he then went on to say that dying to self is actually a positive, not negative. "For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it." Matthew 16, verse 25. So in dying to the self-life, we discover an abundant life by depending on God, who is our only source of supply and provides much more than we can imagine. Now, Jesus put it this way: "Unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit." John 12, verse 24, and Galatians 5, verses 22 through 23. Part of the life we discover when we give our lives to Christ is freedom from a life of self-obsession. As such, we experience the joy of Christ and we become more accepting, more generous, and more loving of others. So, when we die to self, we set aside our wants and desires and instead focus on loving God and valuing others as highly as we value ourselves. Matthew 22, verses 37 through 39. Now, this moves us away from self-centeredness and more open to being a follower of Christ who cares deeply for others. It's much easier to pay attention to the concerns, interests, and needs of other people, Philippians 2, 3 through 4, when we are no longer obsessed with our own interests. Amen? However, dying to self is something that we Christians find hard to do. Now, in this world, where there is pressure on all sides to replace the love of God for something lesser, to die to oneself is something that nearly every believer is adverse to doing. Since we live in a world of instant gratification, dying to oneself itself is a concept that is, well, it's both foreign and unacceptable. Yet, this is one thing that Jesus insisted on. Essentially, the Christian life is an ongoing process of dying to self and living for Christ daily. Seeking his will and kingdom and righteousness rather than our own. Daily. But as fallen humans, we are hardwired to seek our own will above anyone else's. We want our own way in life, and we all have a tendency to see things from our point of view and define the world by how we see it. Although most people deny their own self-centeredness, man by nature is very much self-centered and self-interested. You see, we are not born good or others-oriented. Instead, our fall from grace stemmed from wanting to be like God, Genesis 3, verse 5. As a result, a lot of the aspects of pride that characterized the first man also characterize us. And pride keeps us from receiving God's love. We are so full of ourselves that we are inclined to think that our need for God isn't that great. Because we are proud, we chase after other lovers in an effort to please ourselves. And that's the essence of idolatry, friends. Idolatry takes many forms. A relationship we value more than God, the desire for material wealth that's greater than our love for God. You know, my mother, she's gone home to be with the Lord now, but she used to say that Americans, when she was an American, the American people should put, instead of the torch of liberty in the Statue of Liberty's hand, should put a beer can there. Because that's what they idolized, was the beer can, beer. And, you know, I have to agree that that does seem like that. But, you know, mother wasn't that far off base. So it's that relationship, the desire for material things, material wealth, it's greater than our love for God. The desire to draw attention to ourselves rather than directing the attention of others toward God. The world is full of idols that dethrone God from our hearts. Anything that causes one to have a self-focus rather than a God-focus is a form of pride and is aberrant to God. So the two things that keep us from God and the two main reasons why we need to die to ourselves are pride, self, and idolatry, desires, self and desires, self-desired. So the would-be disciple must deny himself. That is, he must disregard his own interests and die to the willful selfishness and sinful parts of himself. He must let go of his plans and what he wants to do. Now, the issue of dying to self is a process of stripping away layers of sin encrusted with selfishness. And it's an integral part of the process of sanctification. It was the disciples' nature, instinct, and it's natural to them to preserve their own lives. That's natural to us. And that caused them to flee from Christ at his arrest. But self-preservation results in spiritual loss. As we see in Luke 9, verses 24 through 25, listen to this. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. For what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and is himself destroyed or lost? You see, the disciples learned that the Christian life is not about us, it's about Christ, all about Christ. It's about putting God's will over our will. It's about putting Christ first above everything else, no matter what it costs us. It's the realization that we are his servants, and as such, our goal is to live for him and glorify him in everything that we do. Now, when we came to Christ, we chose to make him our Lord and invited him to come live in us. In doing so, we chose to give up our own will for his will. And since we chose to become his child and servant, then we must die to ourselves every single day, every hour, every minute, every second. The greatest hope for each of us as believers is to die to self that we might live for Christ. Dying to self, denying self, is never portrayed in Scripture as something optional in the Christian life. As believers, we are to take up our cross daily and follow Christ. It's our daily cross that makes us weep more than any other thing, that makes us cry out like Jesus, "Father, why is this?" That causes us to run to Christ and put our arms around him. That makes us sick of earth and self, and that gives us a longing for heaven. Paul said, "I die every day," 1 Corinthians 15, verse 31. So then the goal of death to self and daily cross-bearing is fellowship with Christ. Close, intimate relationship and fellowship with Christ. See, the goal of life for the believer is to seek God and make Him their all in all, their last and final end. Here are five ways as suggestions on how that we should embrace the cross. Number one, humiliation. This is the essence of the Christian life. Here, God uses reproaches, abuse, poverty, loneliness, persecution, distress, seeming failure, disappointments, and the like. These things succeed when they cause us to lose our own will and let God take charge. Two, rejecting the praise of men. Self thrives on praise and adulation. Self-esteem is the hotbed of the self-life. Three, embracing simplicity and childlikeness. Self feeds on things grand and glorious. Christ-likeness is childlike and simple. Four, living by pure faith. Self depends on outward assurances. Living by pure faith, trust the word of God, even when there's no indication of God's presence or blessing. Five, seeking our nothingness and His allness. We must make a daily habit to distrust ourselves, our own wisdom, and our own strength, and look to Christ alone for what we need. How does one die to self? Well, I'm going to tell you, my friends, it's no easy task. Since we are embracing ethics that are foreign to our very nature and are not our own making, they belong to Jesus. Dying to self, more often than not, involves a real fight when we try to surrender our will to the will of God. Believe me, back it up. Look at Galatians 5, verse 17 and Ephesians 5, verse 12. However, God gives sufficient grace to those who fight the good fight, as evidenced in John 15, verse 7, 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13, 2 Corinthians 12, verse 9, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16, Philippians 4, verse 13, Colossians 1, verses 9 through 11, 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 18, Hebrews chapter 4, verses 15 and 16, 1 John chapter 5, verse 4. There's a lot of evidence there. By the way, we will never be able to die to ourselves unless we are convinced that serving the flesh, our sin nature, is totally unprofitable. You see, we have to see that it has absolutely no worth at all. We need to come to detest its very presence. On the other hand, we must come to love the Spirit's ways. We are to see the glorious work of the Spirit in contrast to the flesh. And by seeing their contrasting ways, we will hate the one and love the other. Matthew 6, verse 24. See, we refuse to serve our own self-preferences and become wholly loyal to the Holy Spirit's work in our lives. In your quiet moments, talk to God and ask Him to reveal those areas of your life that you need to submit to Him. Because we don't submit them all. We hold back a few. I refer to it as a Swiss cheese. You know, there's holes in the Swiss cheese. And in those holes, there are little dark areas. Well, we may give Him the solid parts that are filled up. But where those holes are, is lurking the things that we need to pull out and get rid of so that our cheese can fill up and be solid. So you need to reveal those areas of your life. Say, ask Him to reveal them to you, to submit to Him. Ask Him for the grace to help you surrender those areas of your life, and ask Him for the grace to help you believe and deliver you from your unbelief. Mark 9, verse 24. The truths gleaned from Romans 6 through 8 are critical for establishing a strong Christian life. Why is this? And what truths are powerfully presented here in Romans? Well, let's see. Paul applies the pattern of Christ's life to our Christian lives, and in so doing, Paul enables us to get a grasp of all of this through the picture of baptism. That's what it tells us. So, let's look at that. We're going to look at this picture of baptism, the down and the up of it. You see, baptism doesn't mean to sprinkle, but it means to immerse, to completely submerge. A Christian doesn't merely acknowledge that Jesus is the Christ. He also follows Christ. He acknowledges both the value of what Christ has done on the cross and the importance on how Jesus redeemed us. We usually focus on what Christ has accomplished through His death. Actually, Paul speaks clearly of this in chapters 3 and 4 of Romans. Chapter 5, however, develops the basis of our union with Christ. So, we are united with Christ by our faith. Starting in chapter 6, we see how this identification with Christ affects our life. The picture of baptism includes three aspects. Number one, the going down. 2, being under, and 3, the raising up. So we might think of rinsing a cloth. Let's use that as an example. We take it from the air, submerge it underwater, and then bring it up out to be used. Humility speaks of the first two steps. Many would like to avoid the implications of these first two very important steps. What they want is to claim to have eternal life with no sense of repentance, no dying. They haven't died to themselves. There has been no funeral. The concept is key to living a fulfilled Christian life, but we seem to have a problem. Paul seems to have discovered a group of people that claim Christ's death, but deny any real identification with Christ in the death process. So, according to them, Christ merely paid for their sins as some historical fact, which it was, of course, and past that, they want to just forget about their close identification with Christ in the process. Know anybody like that? I do. If we consider Christ's death to be so all-important, and it is, then we need to realize its effects on our lives. When Jesus died, he not only bore our sins, but he also was, in a final way, saying no to sin. After death, sin had no part of his life. He had no earthly flesh that begged to be given special preference. So we, as his disciples, must identify with Christ's death and resurrection. We must say no to our former allegiance to sin through our faith and yes to our allegiance to Christ. We now have a new focus on life, and because of this new allegiance, we're not to sin, but to live for God. For the death that he died to sin once for all. But the life that he lives to God. Even so, consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, that you should obey its lusts. Romans 6:10-12. So what about pride? Hate it. We will never be able to die to ourselves unless we are convinced that serving the flesh, our old nature, is totally unprofitable. We have to see that our old nature has absolutely no worth. As I said before, we need to come to detest its very presence. And on the other hand, we have to come to love the Spirit's ways. We're to see the glorious work of the Spirit in contrast to flesh. Then by seeing their contrasting ways, what happens? We hate one and love the other. We refuse to serve our own self-preferences and become wholly loyal to the Holy Spirit's work in our lives. Then, of course, that old fiend, pride, comes nosing around. See, we can't rid ourselves of the flesh on this earth. This is what Jesus referred to in Romans 6:10 when he says, consider yourselves to be dead to sin. It's still there. If we're not cautious, we'll end up serving it. But we don't have to. By voiding our allegiance to our flesh, we can, by Christ's grace, be set free to serve only Christ. And you know what? That doesn't make you a fanatic. Actually, that should be the norm. But how do we void our former allegiance to our flesh and avoid the flesh? Well, Paul says death is the only means, and he explains it very specifically in Romans 7:1-6. The point is that unless we are absolutely convinced that the flesh is a destroyer, we will continue to listen to it and follow it. We will, in essence, continue to serve it. Now, as Christians, we are technically free from its rule over us, but we still can fall into serving the old self. It's like a rubber band snapping and pulling us back. So we have to cut that rubber band so that it doesn't come up behind us and try to usurp us and take us back over. So then the follow-up question is this. Whether we really hate the flesh, are we really convinced? Well, Paul convincingly set forth this case in the last part of chapter 7 and the early part of chapter 8 in Romans. Whenever he would go by the old nature, he would serve his own self and bear evil results. But he wanted to serve Christ, Romans 7, which brings forth the fruit of the Spirit. See Galatians 5 for your evidence, folks. The flesh always brings about death because it's hostile to God, Romans 8. So we ought not to live for our bodies. We don't need to live for ourselves. We need to humble ourselves by stating that serving ourselves is not good. In a sense, this is what dying to self essentially means. We recognize serving self is no good, and so we choose to serve the Spirit. These chapters provide a lot of help in convincing us of the horrible nature of the flesh and the marvelous glory of the Spirit. Commitment to saying no to the old nature comes only as much as, 1, we are sure of the old nature's total rebellion against God, and 2, we desire to serve the Spirit. You see, our growth comes as we recognize the complete rebellious nature of the flesh and the power of the new life through the life of Christ. So, dying to self means simply a mental check on our determination not to live for oneself and to live only then for Christ. Paul in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 31 says, I die daily. So we can see that this is a regular battle, a daily battle, moment by moment, second by second. Paul, as a veteran apostle, witnessing many miracles, seeing a revelation of Christ, still had to personally die to himself. We do too. We quite simply can't afford not to. Here's a possible prayer for your early morning meditation. Pray with me now. Dear Lord, my allegiance to you will be tested today. Right now, I'm stating my faithfulness to you. You are the one I love forever. At the same time, I will clearly state that I want nothing to do with serving myself. I have had enough to do with that selfish ego of mine that tries to get all the attention it can. Your principles of love and giving are what I want. Radiate in my life through acts and words of kindness. Forgive me of my sin and cleanse me. I make myself totally empty of self so that you can fill me with your precious Holy Spirit. Lead me forth. I will follow in your humble paths of love. See, the Christian needs to acknowledge the flesh, declare its lousy nature, reject its promptings, acknowledge the Lord's presence, acknowledge the beautiful nature of the Spirit, and affirm one's total heart and will to the Spirit's leading. Christian life, well, it's based on humble living, my friends. And when we are willing to humble ourselves by looking at the facts of what self-service does, then we will see that we are willing to walk in that path. Did you receive this today? I pray that you did. If you need further explanation of these messages or understanding of any of them, please contact me. I can be reached at masterstouchhs@gmail.com. That's masterstouchhs@gmail.com. I want you to understand the reason why I just give you my email address, because I teach and broadcast every day, all day. And I can only talk on the phone in between classes for maybe 5 minutes. And so it's not really enough time to give you to devote to your situations and questions. So if you email me and put your contact information in there, I will contact you back. And I'm going to repeat that now as I tell you that you're invited if you want to. If you have a call in your life, or you're looking for more of God, or you're thinking of going into the ministry in any branch, missions, leadership, worship, including the fivefold ministry, I want you to consider the Master's Touch Healing School of Ministry International for your education and edification. Our website address is themasterstouchhs.org, themasterstouchhs.org. Email masterstouchhs@gmail.com. That's masterstouchhs@gmail.com. You can contact me on Facebook on POET, capital P, capital O, capital E, capital T with a dot in between them, which is the P, and then there's an equal sign, Peace on Earth Team, equals Peace on Earth Team. So you can reach me there, or the Master's Prayer Room, these are on Facebook now, or Master's Touch Healing School, or Stefeni Engebritsen. Leave a brief message with your contact information, and I will get back to you as quickly as I have a break between classes. To assist you with securing your education, what we've done is developed all kinds of financial assistance programs, including scholarships and life experience credits. So contact us for more information. masterstouchhs@gmail.com. It's masterstouch, then HS. But it's all run together. So it's going to go Master's Touch, I'll spell it, masterstouchhs, okay, @gmail.com. You know, my friends, Proverbs 4, verse 7 tells us wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom, and with all of your getting, get understanding. That's exactly what we're doing here. Listen, we're seeking for and gaining God's wisdom, so make sure you're keeping Jesus Lord of your life. The Master's Word's a subsidiary of the Master's Touch Healing School of Ministry International, a 501c3 organization. Have a blessed and wonderful week, and tune in every Monday morning at 10 a.m. right here on Spreaker.com for the Master's Word. I just want to let you know I was a little bit late today. I was having some technical issues to deal with, but we finally got on. So now, hang in there and give us at least 5 minutes. Sometimes we have to have that. because of technicalities. God bless you. Have a wonderful week. And I'll see you Monday.